Jerry Rozett, served in World War II in the U.S. Navy. It's for the Veterans History Project. Today's date is May 17, 2007 in Washington, D.C. And Jerry, why don't you get us started by sharing with us where you were, what you were doing before the war broke out, and then what did you do when you heard about Pearl Harbor, and then how did you get into the military, and kind of take us from there.
Okay. Well, I was born in New York City and was smart enough when I was 3 to move to Yonkers, New York, where I grew up. Went through school, graduated from high school. I don't believe there was enough money for college for us. I was one of 7 children. So I went to work as an electrician's helper. When Pearl Harbor occurred, because my father had been in the Navy in World War I, I decided that I would volunteer for the Navy in this one. Went down on the 3rd of January to sign up. I think I was sworn in on the 26th of January of 1942. Went to boot camp in Newport, Rhode Island for 5 weeks, and was sent from there to electrician's mate school in Detroit, Michigan, at the Naval Armory. When I graduated from there, I believe I was about 15th in a class of 120 some odd, and was sent to Gyro Compass School in Brooklyn at the Navy Yard. I received a third class rating, electrician's mate rating, when I graduated from the electrician's mate school. I completed the Gyro Compass School, and I was given the rating of second class electrician's mate, although I couldn't get it until I had enough time in to earn it. Then I was assigned to put a ship in commission down in Philadelphia at the cramped shipyards. We put the USS Merino, the AT-87 at the time, on November 30th, 1942. After that, we did the usual shakedown cruise and went down to down the inland waterway to Norfolk, and did our shakedown cruise out in the Chesapeake Bay.
What kind of ship was it, Jerry?
Oh, it was a fleet tug, 205 foot long, 38 foot 6 beam, 1,500 tons. It had a crew of 89 men and officers. A good-sized seagoing tug. After our shakedown, we went down to Bermuda and back to the States, and then down to into a convoy bound for the other side, and it consisted of 24 LCIs, landing craft infantry, and 24 LSTs, landing ship tank. We were along to keep up any ships that broke down on the voyage, and the LSTs, we towed, I guess, most of them at one time or another to keep them up with the convoy while they did minor repairs. We went to Gibraltar, back down to Casablanca, And we were to stand by another ship that had been torpedoed in the original attack on Casablanca. We left in a convoy with that ship bound for the States, and on the way back, inadvertently, I blew the main contacts on our propulsion board, and our ship was dead in the water for perhaps 45 minutes while the convoy left us. Once we were repaired, we got on our way and caught up with the convoy. But,
Terry, why don't you explain briefly what your responsibilities were?
My responsibility on that ship, since it was a diesel-electric propelled ship, the propulsion system was electric, and therefore my rating as an electrician's mate would be at the throttle on the propulsion board. I was the one who made the ship go or stop, and you know, on orders from the bridge. At any rate, we got back to the States, went into the yard, did some minor repairs and upkeep. Went down to Bermuda again, and left with a convoy that carried the 45th Division across for the invasion of Sicily. That was quite a convoy. We were the slowest ship in the convoy. And that convoy was written up in a book by John Mason Brown called To All Hands. I believe he was on the ship that was in charge of the entire convoy, and one chapter was written about our tug, because we were the slow one in the convoy.
What year was that?
That was in 1943. We went across and went through the Straits of Gibraltar, and went into port in Iran, Algeria, in North Africa. From there we went in short hops up the coast of North Africa and ended up eventually in Bizerte, in Tunis, I believe that is. And that was pretty much our base until we went on the invasion of Sicily. We survived a number of air raids at Bizerte. Actually had to give up one or two members of our crew to another ship who had lost men in the air raid. While we were there, we took on salvage and firefighting gear, and salvage and firefighting men for the invasion of Sicily. We went in with the landing ship tanks, towing a pontoon causeway for one LST. We dropped it off, wished them good luck, and they went on in to hit the beach. After that, we did, while we were at Sicily, we did firefighting and salvage. We went to work towing an LCI off the beach. And in the midst of towing it, we were attacked by four Stuka dive bombers, and we were kicking up a wake that would indicate we were doing about 15 knots, although we were not moving because of the tow wire to the LST that was stuck on the beach. The bombs they dropped landed right ahead of us and really rocked our ship. But if we had been moving, we would have been a dead duck. I think eventually we got the LCI off the beach. And we did various salvage and firefighting jobs and went on up to Marcellus, Sicily at the northwestern corner where the great winery for the king is, where Marcella wine is made. We cleared the harbor of sunken ships and laid out marker buoys through the minefields there, and ran very low on food because we had taken in, we had about 2 weeks supply on board when we left Bizerte, plus the 2 weeks we'd taken on for the invasion, and we stayed in Sicily for 6 weeks. Most of the crew members lost 10 or 15 pounds. Luckily we didn't run out of coffee or beans or spaghetti, but the rest of our food was pretty low. We traded some line to local fishermen for fish, and we begged some K rations from the paratroops that were holding the town. We finally got orders to go back to Bizerte and replenish our food supplies. After that, we did various towing jobs. It seems we never left port without something in tow, a landing craft or a barge or a salvage camel or something of the sort, or a damaged ship. And eventually went back to Bizerte and then to Palermo, and which had been taken by that time, and prepared for the invasion of Salerno. We went in with the attack transports at Salerno to make sure we could keep those up with the convoy in case they broke down or were damaged. And on our way in, we got word that Italy had surrendered. We hit the beach at least the landing craft and the attack transports that we had brought in, hit the beach and had a rough time before they got firmly established. We did a lot of firefighting and salvage work. We towed the HMS Warspite, British battleship, down to Malta with the assistance of our sister ship and a British tug. We were the first ships alongside the Savannah when she was hit by a radio-controlled glider bomb.
What kind of ship was the Savannah?
Savannah was a cruiser.
And how'd you help out the Savannah?
I believe all we did was drop off some salvage pumps to assist them in getting rid of some of the water that they had taken on from the hit. And they had flooded down the, they'd been hit right near, I think it was the number three turret. And they had to flood down their ammo storage area to prevent that from going out and blowing the ship up. So we dropped the salvage pumps off so they could drain that. And she went under her own power out of there for, I don't know where she ended up, for repairs until she went back to the States for permanent repairs.
Can you explain how the Savannah was hit?
She was hit by a radio-controlled glider bomb that was towed in by a German plane, cut loose and controlled by the pilot of that plane until it was over the target. Then the wings were dropped off, and it came down like a rocket to hit the ship. That was also the, I believe, the way the warspite was hit.
Can you explain how the Allies started to overcome that technology?
Yes, I believe shortly after the first radio-controlled glider bombs were used, the Navy, I believe, took a destroyer escort and outfitted it with quite a bit of electronic gear for searching for the control frequency, and a transmitter to take over control of the glider bomb. And it was funny, they brought in a glider bomb and cut it loose, and we'd take control and chase the plane with it. They didn't use them after that, once they found we could control them better than they could. During the attack on Salerno, our sister ship, the USS Rozett, was hit by a bomb and set afire, and she was being towed in by a smaller tug to beach it, to try to save it when they hit a mine, and she went down with about 35 men of her crew. I believe that was the only tug that was lost in the European theater. And after they secured Salerno, we made many, many trips between down from Salerno to Palermo to Bizerte, back up to Naples, back and forth many times, towing ships, towing salvage equipment, or what have you, retrieving damaged ships and handing them off to ATAs, which were auxiliary tugs, but were not meant for battle. They were meant for long-distance towing. And they'd tow them back to the States, if that's the way they were headed. I was over there in the Mediterranean, going back and forth between Naples and Bizerte, I saw Mount Vesuvius in eruption, Mount Stromboli in eruption, and Mount Etna in eruption. All three Italian
volcanoes.
Volcanoes. All three of them active. It's quite a sight. Eventually, after towing all sorts of things around, we ended up in a town north of Naples, getting ready for the invasion of southern France. And we hooked up with a convoy of LCTs, all loaded with tanks or trucks or what have you. And about every fifth one of them had a barrage balloon on it. We left in the convoy with several other tugs and I believe a couple of minesweeps, and headed for Corsica. We stopped in there overnight, but on the way we had to pick up LCTs that were disabled. They tended to get lines or wires caught in their propellers and couldn't keep up with the convoy. We'd pick them up and take them in tow, and then the next tug would take the next one in tow, and if another one broke down, we'd take that in tow behind the first one, and just to make sure they all got where they were going. And we left Corsica, was kind of cute, the birthplace of Napoleon, headed for the nation he led to take it over from the Germans. On the way with the convoy, we could see behind us other convoys. You could tell there were convoys because of LCTs, because of the barrage balloons that were, is all we could see above the horizon.
Can you explain what a barrage balloon is?
Barrage balloon is a balloon inflated with helium, and on a 1/8 inch wire, steel wire, I believe they were about 1,500 feet long, and they would keep those in the air to keep dive bombers from getting close to the targets. And they were brought in easily on LCTs. You could see barrage balloons over the horizon with the next convoys that were coming. Eventually we passed Elba, where Napoleon had been exiled, and went on into southern France. We hit the beaches at Saint-Rifel on the south coast of France. We carried a Commodore. We were in charge of the Eastern Task Force for salvage and firefighting. So we had the senior firefighting and salvage commander on our ship during the invasion. And we eventually towed things off the beach, fought fires on ships, patched ships, did all kinds of repair and firefighting work, and eventually cleaned off the beaches and then went on into Marseille and Toulon. And eventually it ended up back in Palermo, and I was rated chief electrician's mate at the appointment, temporary. Raid. If I had stayed in after the war, I would have gone back to second class electrician's mate. But at any rate, when I went ashore in Palermo to go to buy my new uniforms, the chief's uniform, I jumped on the back of a I guess it was a 6x6 weapon carrier or what have you truck, and tore the cartilage in my left knee. And I did get ashore and get to ship stores and bought my uniform. Got back to the ship and bent my knee and couldn't get up. I slept with my knee under my chin all night. The next morning I went down to the dispensary and they sent me into the a villa where they the Navy had taken over as a hospital and had the torn cartilage removed. In the meantime, my ship left, and after I was sent out of the hospital to the receiving station, I was supposed to go back to the dispensary for treatments, but some yeoman got in a hurry and shipped me out. I was sent up to Naples by plane, my first plane ride on an old DC-3. And the only treatment I ever got for that torn cartilage was heat treatment at the dispensary in Naples. After that, I was shipped back to Palermo. Back to Bizerte. When we flew over Palermo, I saw my ship down in the harbor. And when we landed, I called, and I thought they were going on to Bizerte, so I went on to Bizerte, as my orders called for. That was the time the ship eventually ended up in Naples and picked up the repair ship Tackle, an old clunker of a ship the Navy had taken over, and started towing it into Odessa, Russia in the Black Sea. In the meantime, I flew on to Oran and spent 5 or 6 weeks waiting for my ship to come back out.
What did you do while you were hanging out in Iran?
While I was in Iran, I lived in a Quonset hut outside of Iran. Used to take the mail truck in every morning, go to operations office to try to find out where my ship was, and eventually ended up over at the Red Cross Club. They had taken over a public building that had 102 steps out in front. And I spent hours walking up and down the steps, loosening up my stiff knee, until eventually I could squat down on my heels. But it took weeks and weeks of work. Eventually my ship came back out, and I went back aboard and sailed with her to, we went into a convoy, went through the Straits of Gibraltar, and had to wait while they sent the dirigible over the convoy to check out to make sure no submarine had come out with us. Then we went on, we left the convoy, went to the Azores to help repair a Liberty ship that had bounced on a rock and broken their skag, which is an extension of the keel that supports the bottom portion of the rudder. They had already flooded down number one and two holds on the Liberty ship to tilt her bow down and get her stern out of water. They had cut off the damaged skeg, taken the rudder into port where they straightened the rudder post, and the salvage men from the ship, ship we were towing, that repair ship, the salvage men from that rebuilt the skeg, and they reinserted the rudder and got the Liberty ship back on its way. And then we joined another convoy and came back to the States. Again, while we were out at sea, Germany surrendered. Second country to surrender while I was out at sea. We got back to the States, and I got 30 days leave. And eventually, after my leave and after some intensive upkeep on the ship, we went down to Charleston, picked up a floating dry dock with a 3,000-ton oiler up in it, and picked up a yard tug, and were bound for Guam from Charleston. It was funny because the yard tug could not throttle back slow enough to keep back with us. If we had a tailwind, we could do about 4 knots, and if we were bucking a headwind, we'd make about 2 knots, because that floating dry dock just didn't want to go anywhere. We refueled off Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, from another fleet tug. And then we went on down to Panama. The floating dry dock had been was made of concrete, and she'd been damaged in a storm that we hit on the way from Guantanamo to Panama. And we got her into shallow water where she sank, but they were able to make repairs on her and refloated. It was in shallow water, so it didn't matter. In the meantime, we took a, I believe it was a barracks barge halfway through the canal, and then came back out to get our dry dock. Took her into the freshwater portion of the canal, and all seagoing ships are left overnight in the freshwater to kill off all the growth on the hull. Freshwater kills off all the saltwater growth. And then we went on through the rest of the canal, and the day before we left the canal was the day they dropped the bomb on Hiroshima. And I went ashore and smuggled a fifth of scotch, Johnny Walker Red Label, back to the ship. It was great being a chief, I could do that. At any rate, on the way up from Panama, with the war ending, we originally were bound for Guam with that dry dock and oiler. And they had us drop it off in San Diego. But on the way, we stopped off to refuel in Manzanillo, Mexico. And then off the west coast of Southern California, we saw a whale. And while we were towing the ship, the dry dock, our tow wire vibrated. And the whale came up and sounded on one side. Then it went down below, and the tow wire vibrated again, and it came up on the other side. The darn whale was scratching its back on our tow wire. We figured the whale must have been somewhere between 40 and 50 feet long. Eventually, we dropped the tow off in San Diego and went on to Long Beach and operated out of there for a while. But on the way up from Manzanillo, the Japanese surrendered. The third surrender when I was out at sea. Never got a welcoming party or got to kiss all the pretty girls on the day of victory. But eventually, I got off the ship and went back to went off the ship on the 7th of November, 1945, and went to the receiving station. Waiting transport, and went back on a train with a bunch of cattle cars, a troop train, and left Long Beach, California, went into Long Beach, Long Island, where I was discharged on the 24th of November, 1945.
Well, Jerry, if you don't mind, I'd like to go back and ask you a couple questions.
Sure.
Did you ever run into any German submarines when you were in the Mediterranean?
When we brought our first convoy over, just outside of Gibraltar, our sonar man, who was up on the bridge, I believe he was in the chart room, told the captain a torpedo's been fired at us, and the captain said, "Oh, bullshit." And the sonar man said, "Excuse me, sir," and he went past the captain, got his life jacket and put it back on, and the captain had them swing the ship. And one of the men who had served in the torpedo testing grounds for the Navy somewhere in the States said that he saw the wake of a torpedo about 50 yards off our stern after we'd swung the ship around. That was about the closest we ever came to disaster, other than bombs. I think during all the action we survived, I believe it was 120 air raids by the Germans or Italians.
Did you guys ever, now you mentioned the Stuka dive bombers you guys had a very close encounter with. Did you guys ever shoot down any planes?
During all the action, we finally shot down four German planes. During the invasions, of course, when they were bombing attacks and fighter attacks on the convoys or on the invasion fleets. I think one of the highlights of my time in the Navy, since I was a gyro compass man on board our tug, I was able to go up on the bridge almost any time I wanted to check the gyro repeaters. And while we were going into the attack on southern France, the evening before we hit the beach, I went up in the chart room and read through the entire invasion plan. It was a book about an inch and a half thick. It included the sailing points of all vessels that were involved in the invasion or the aftermath of the invasion, ships from every port on the east coast of the United States, all across North Africa. The British ships came from Gibraltar and parts of England, and all the cruisers and battle wagons came from places like Palermo and Oran for the invasion of southern France. The LSTs and LCIs would come from places like Naples. And of course the LCTs, the smaller ones, came north of Naples and Corsica. But they all converged on that one spot, a few miles long, along the beach in southern France. And although they don't like to admit it, that convoy was larger than the one that hit northern France in Normandy, because we didn't have close-up support like they did over there. They were, you know, less than 50 miles away from Britain, and they could send ships back and forth across easily, whereas all the ships involved in the invasion of southern France came once. We had to have enough of them to do the whole thing. It really, my reading that those plans really showed up what was involved in the planning of an invasion. Just a tremendous amount of work.
Terry, what's one of the most vivid memories you have of your experience in the war? What's the one thing that probably stands out to you the most that you?
It's kind of interesting. In all the firefighting and salvage and everything, and I went aboard burning ships, manning fire hose to back up a firefighter. You know, and I was there on the ship during all the bombing raids and everything else, and the scariest thing I ever went through, and the one really brave thing I did, and it didn't amount to a row of beans, was in Sicily. a minesweep, an AM, was hit by a mine amidships and blew a hole in her side and killed a bunch of men and set fire to their one engine room and their mess hall. And we went out to bring them back in, and we thought she was going to sink. So we put a big salvage line down in the engine room to try to keep her afloat. And I put that salvage line down there, and I knew there was a chief machinist mate, a dead chief machinist mate down in there floating around somewhere. And I was scared stiff, but I went down there. That was the one brave thing I did during the war. And it turns out, we found out after pumping all night, we found out, we sent a diver down, that the hole in her side was big enough to drive a Jeep through, so our salvage pump didn't do a thing. That was the one time I was really terrified, but did my job anyway. And I guess most of us had times like that. We were trained, we did things not because we wanted to, but because that's what we had to do.
Well, that kind of leads me into my next question to you, Jerry. How did your wartime experiences affect your life?
I believe through the GI Bill, when I got out of the service, it allowed me to go to college. I never would have had the opportunity. I didn't quite graduate from college, but almost made it, and it changed the rest of my life. I spent most of my career as an engineer.
What company? Working
for various companies. I was an engineer for IBM. I repaired some of their old electromechanical monsters that handled punch cards before the days of computers. I ran a research and development lab for a division of American Standard, making precision miniature switches, doing all the tests and what have you on them, making test equipment for them. I worked as an electrical estimator for an electrical construction company, estimating all sorts of construction jobs. I worked as a maintenance superintendent in a Manning Maxwell and Moore, which manufactured gauges, pressure gauges mostly. I had a crew of 40 maintenance men. I was in charge of all the changes made in the plant. The plant, by the way, employed about 1,000 people. Did some pretty good work with them, but ended up as a project engineer in a research and development company that did a lot of work for space, an infrared company, Barnes Engineering. They made horizon sensors for some of our space shots. They made, Dr. Barnes was the one who invented the original infrared camera. Not that the present ones are anything like that one. That was a device that did some manual scanning of people. It took 6 minutes for a full scan of a person. But they were doing a lot of research for the services for Arctic clothing and that sort of thing. And While I was with them, I was the one who maintained the temperature standard for the company. I had dealings with the National Bureau of Standards and actually developed a piece of test equipment for transferring the accuracy from our master that had been tested by the National Bureau of Standards and certified to the devices we put into equipment that we sold. While I was there, I helped disassemble a horizon sensor that had gone up in the shot when they sent the first monkey up into a suborbital shot. He went up and came down, and I helped disassemble that horizon sensors that were on that spacecraft. After I left them, I was transferred up to a place in Waltham as the head of the maintenance department there, and I revised all their operation there from a garage-type operation to a really sophisticated laboratory-type operation. When they tried to transfer me back down to the plant in Stamford, I commuted for about 6 months, but then got a job up in New Hampshire. I didn't want to leave the country up there. And I ended up eventually with, after 12 years, I retired from Colesman, which was a company that manufactured aircraft altimeters and weapon systems. I was a senior facilities engineer in charge of changes in the buildings. We put on two major additions in the buildings, made all the changes on the interior, the exterior of the buildings. Had quite a career there. And eventually retired in 1988 at the age of 67.
Well, Jerry, did your war experience, coming out of everything you saw and did during the war, did it change your perspective on life any? Did you look at life a little bit differently when you came back home?
I think I enjoyed life a lot more. Realized how lucky I was to come through the war pretty much in one piece. I had two brothers who were in the service. One, my younger brother, became a pilot and flew B-17s out of England over Germany and France and what have you. My older brother, Art, was a weather forecaster. He ended up out in Montana. He never left the States. But all three of us came back home pretty much in one piece. And we were lucky. I don't think any of us had bad dreams over the war. I think we all had pretty healthy attitudes. I think I was very fortunate. I didn't remember all the gruesome details that I saw during the war. My memory just wiped them out, which I think was a great thing. I think some people just had to look at dead bodies and had nightmares over it. I didn't look for them, but I saw them and forgot it.
Well, is there any kind of final thoughts you want to share?
During the war, I kept a diary. It was not legal at the time. It was a court-martial offense. But I managed to do it and eventually published it with my daughter. And it was published in a magazine, the Sea Classics, back in the year 2000. I think the experience I had during the war was great. It was a big part of my, of who I am now. It certainly influenced the rest of my life. I wouldn't have missed it for anything. And I wouldn't do it again for anything.
All right. Well, Gerard, I appreciate you coming in today and sharing your experiences with us.
Well, thank you.